Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to worship on this beautiful day, the first day that feels like fall. And I hope that some of you are enjoying the cooler temperatures. I want to tell you that we had the best day yesterday. Yesterday was our festival. The weather cooperated, thank you, God. And we had probably between 150 or 200 people at the festival, and they had a wonderful time with the petting zoo and the pumpkin making and all of that. And I have to say, you can't do that kind of an event alone. And I had a lot of help, but especially from Betty Nathanson. So Betty, thank you. And I also want to thank all of the other people who came during the week, that came yesterday to set up and take down. It was a major event, and we really appreciated all of the help. And so we have a number of announcements this week. I hope you'll look at the ones in the bulletin. But I just wanted to point out that the Advisory Council and I agree that we think it is safe to sing one hymn if you are comfortable with it. And so the very first hymn is one that we'll all sing together. We're not going to stand to sing. We'll just stay seated, but we're going to be able to sing a hymn and leave our masks on. Also today, our book club is meeting in the parlor, and so if you're part of that, you want to be there. On Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we continue with bell rehearsal, and next Sunday, the bells will be playing for you, so we're really looking forward to that. On Thursday morning at 8 a.m., we have the men's breakfast in Fellowship Hall. And I also want to let you know that Jen Barr is on the board. I believe it's called the Bay Atlantic Symphony. I hope I have the name right, but it's at Stockton. And they're giving an all-string concert on Halloween afternoon, on the 31st, at 2 o'clock. So even if you're involved with some children for trick-or-treating, or you want to get home in time to give out some treats, you'll be able to do that and do both things. So these tickets are like less than half price. They're $15 a piece, and so she gets them in a block. And so if you are interested in going that day, please call her or see me or call the office, and we'll make sure she gets the tickets. Also, save the date. We're looking ahead. You know, you always plan way ahead in church. We're looking to do a Christmas dinner dance at Josie Kelly's on December the 12th. That's a Sunday afternoon around 5 o'clock or 5:30. And we're trying to get that all together. The details will be following, but please mark your calendars for that. You know that around this time every year, we start thinking about next year's budget. And so if you haven't already received a letter from me, you will. And it has an estimate of giving card in the envelope. We just need to know what to expect or hope to expect in support from the congregation and friends in the next few weeks. We will be dedicating those estimate cards, and that's all they are, is an estimate of what you can give back to the Lord. And we'll dedicate them on Thanksgiving Sunday, which is very apropos because we are giving thanks to God for all our blessings at that time. And so please prayerfully and carefully consider what your gifts to the Lord will be. And now let us begin worship with the introit.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you.
Please join me in the call to worship. Let us declare the greatness of God. Causes the sea to shout praise.
And the birds to sing with
Great and loving is our God. Sending friends to listen and embrace. Holy and awesome is our God. Whispering comfort in the darkest night. God holds us with infinite and tender care. Let us worship God. Precious God, surround us with your presence so we may breathe deeply of this moment and discover a fountain of joy, a stream of hope. Precious God, come in word and silence, in song and prayer, and lead us to you. Precious God, visit us now with your peace and power that makes all things new. Renew our world and us all by your grace. Amen. I know it's not in the bulletin, but I have time with the children and I see two victims, my grandkids. Come on up, guys. Hi, Abby, hi, Gabriel. Okay, you want to just sit right down on the floor over here? Okay. Now, you know, I know that you guys are pretty young yet, 7 and 8, 6 and 7. Okay. I'm putting you ahead already. Okay, 6 and 7. Do either of you know who Mr. Rogers is? Your daddy does. Your daddy watched that show every morning when he was a little boy your age. And he was on TV for a long time on a show called Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And when he came in at the beginning of the show, he always did the same thing. He took his sweater, or put his sweater on and put sneakers on and then sang a song. I'm not going to do that. Won't you be my neighbor? He would sing words like, it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Okay. Can you put it over the no. We don't want to lose that jacket. No. Anyway, he would say, won't you be my neighbor? Well, you know what? In the Bible, there's a story about a lawyer who came to Jesus and asked him a question. He said, who is my neighbor? And Jesus didn't answer him immediately. Jesus told a story, and the story is called the story of the Good Samaritan. Now, what happened in the story is a man got beat up really bad, and the robbers just left him on the ground and took everything from him. And then two religious guys, a priest and a helper, temple helper, came by, and they looked at him and ran away. And then a man came by who wouldn't necessarily like that man on the ground, and the man on the ground wouldn't have necessarily liked him. There was just something about each other they didn't like. But you know what? That man was the Samaritan. And he went over and he helped the man. He put bandages on his wounds, and then he took him to an inn and took care of him and gave money for his care, and he paid his medical bills. And then he went on his way. He went out of his whole time and schedule to help that man. And that was very important. And then Jesus said to the guy who asked him a question, he said, who was that man's neighbor? Was it the priest and the helper, or the man who helped him? And exactly, the man who helped him was his neighbor. And you know, we live in a world where there's a ton of people who need our help every single day. And Jesus tells us to do the same thing. He tells us to be good neighbors, to help people when we can, to be kind and good. And it doesn't matter if they look different from us or we may not like them right away. Jesus wants us to be helpers. And that's a very important thing. So he asks, won't you be my neighbor? Let's pray together, okay? Dear Jesus, you have taught us to love our neighbors. Help us to be good neighbors to everyone we meet. Amen. Okay, you guys can go to Sunday school with Miss Betty. As you might guess, the scripture passage this morning is the story of the Good Samaritan found in Luke's Gospel, the 10th chapter. So listen for God's word to you. One day, an expert in religious law, some translations say lawyer, stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question. Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus replied, what does the law of Moses say? How do you read it? The man answered, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus told him, do this and you will live. The man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho and was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead by the side of the road. By chance, a priest came along, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant, some translations call it a Levite walked over and looked at him lying there, and he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you next time I'm here. Now, which of these 3 would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, the one who showed him mercy. Then Jesus said, yes, now go and do the same. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Now, you've probably heard some jokes that kind of end with a Bible character or something from the Bible. I couldn't resist these this morning. Why couldn't Jonah trust the ocean? Because he knew there was something fishy about it. I didn't say they were great jokes. Who was the greatest female financier in the Bible? Pharaoh's daughter. She went down to the bank of the Nile and took out a little profit. No groaning. Who was the greatest male financier in the Bible? Noah. He floated his stock while the rest of the world was in liquidation. Okay, this is not a real groaner. On the ark, Noah probably got milk from the cows. What did he get from the ducks? Quackers. Okay, last one, promise. What's the color of the first ambulance in the Bible? In Luke 10, either gray or brown. The Samaritan's donkey. Which leads us to that familiar story of the Good Samaritan that Jesus told as an answer to the question of the Jewish lawyer, what do I have to do to have eternal life? Well, I'd like to rephrase his question this way this morning. What things do real people of God, real Christians, do? After all, if we believe in Jesus, if we trust in Jesus, we're supposed to live changed lives. Being a Christian, being a disciple of Jesus, is not some matter of magic knowledge that we lock in our hearts and just bury there and use as an insurance policy to get into heaven someday. The Bible teaches us that those who believe in Jesus are transformed people. So if they're transformed, if we're transformed, surely there should be some evidence of that transformation. So where's the evidence? What's the proof? What do real Christians do that distinguishes them from others? Well, that's the essence of the lawyer's question, and Jesus answered it in that parable, that familiar parable. The lawyer was asking what Jesus saw were the essential requirements of the law. I can just see Jesus smiling when he did that. After all, Jesus is God. He wrote the law. He knew what was in it. And so he throws the question right back in the lawyer's lap. He says, how do you interpret it? And the lawyer's answer is one he knows Jesus will approve: to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus had in fact taught that all the law and the prophets hung on those two instructions. And Jesus added, now go and do it. But you see, the lawyer, like many of us, we know the right answers, but sometimes we're totally lost when it comes to what we're actually supposed to do. When Jesus begins this story, we don't know anything about the man who was attacked. Jesus just says, a certain man. We would probably say, some guy. Just some guy that was attacked. Just another human being. Maybe a good one, maybe not so good. We don't know. And this translation says he was Jewish. But I wonder if anyone who passed by would have known that, since he had been beaten so badly. I don't know. But Jesus tells us that two religious men walked by. The first one, a priest, considered the holiest of people in Jewish society. He taught the scriptures. He was entrusted with offering sacrifices for the sin of the people. If anyone would reflect the character of God, surely it would have been the priest. But when he sees this poor beaten man, he practically runs across the street. He gets as far away as fast as he can. Now, I've heard lots of excuses for this behavior, like blood and ritual cleanliness to go to work. But it doesn't hold water because the man was going away from Jerusalem. He was finished work. He was on his way home. He could have stopped and helped that man. And then Jesus moves on in the Jewish hierarchy to a Levite, a helper, a temple helper. They're also highly regarded in Jewish society, but obviously not as holy as the priest. This assistant reminds me of rubberneckers that we see on the highway when there's an accident. We call them gapers. It makes our gaper delays. He wants a closer look, so he goes over and kind of looks at this poor man on the ground, and then he probably said yuck or gagged or something, and he walks away as fast as he can. Now, these religious guys probably had a number of excuses to not help. The great evangelist, Charles Spurgeon, once said, "I never knew a man refuse to help who failed to have at least one admirable excuse." We know the excuses, we've heard them. I was in a hurry. I needed to get home. The needs were more than I could take care of myself. Someone else will do it. If people see me with him, maybe they'll think I committed the crime, or the robbers might come back and get me. If you notice, they're all about me-isms, looking out for number one, not about the person who needed help. At this point in the story, I bet the people who were gathered around Jesus listening to it would have thought that Jesus was going to say, a nice Jewish person, a lay person, helped the poor man. After all, Jesus had been very critical of the hypocritical clergy. So this would have been the perfect time to do it again. The two clergymen walked by the poor man, but the regular guy, the lay person, stopped and helped. So when Jesus surprises them and says, then a Samaritan came by, the crowd would have gotten really quiet, might have had some gasps. They would have never imagined Jesus would say that. You see, there was a mutual hatred between Samaritan and Jews that went back hundreds of years. They might have expected that Jesus would say the Samaritan finished him off. We 21st century Christians glibly call this the parable of the Good Samaritan. But the Jews in Jesus' day didn't use good and Samaritan in the same sentence unless it was to say good riddance. But it was the Samaritan who obeyed the law, not the holy men from the temple. The law said, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Or as Jesus simplified it, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If you had been robbed and beaten and left for dead on the side of the road, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that you would want someone like that Samaritan to come over and help you, to take care of your wounds, to take you someplace safe. Well, let me tweak the story for a minute and give it a modern-day twist. Suppose there's an American traveler overseas, not so much these days with COVID, but we can imagine it, overseas, and he gets beaten by some robbers and left on the side of the road. Two Americans walk by and don't help the man. That would be awful not to help your fellow citizen. But then a member of the Taliban, or ISIS, becomes the Good Samaritan and stops to give aid. He shows behavior that we like to think of as Christian behavior. He shows compassion. He becomes a good neighbor. Compassion is a huge issue here in this story. First of all, compassion cannot be driven by the worth of the recipient, and that's determined in our less than humble opinion. Our compassion must come from the needs we see in other people. The Samaritan knew nothing about his victim, but he was willing to invest his time and his money on someone who might not have liked him at all. That didn't matter to the Samaritan because he was moved by something bigger than racial discriminations or class differences. He was moved by compassion. The Greek word here that's used for compassion is a vivid one. It comes from a word that comes from your insides, like your intestines. It's the equivalent of what we say when we say gut feeling, a feeling that comes from the deepest part of who we are. And almost every time that it's used in the New Testament, it refers to the love of Jesus or the love of God the Father. It's a deep and inescapable passion. It literally means with passion. And when passion exists, you need to take action. What that Samaritan looked at the suffering man on that half-dead on the side of the road, something happened in his gut, something that made it impossible for him to walk away. He didn't decide to help the guy on the basis of how worthy he was. He helped him because he was so needy. The Samaritan didn't help the man because he deserved it, but simply because he needed it. When real, live, gut-level compassion sees desperate need at work, it does whatever it can to help. That's the kind of compassion that real Christians demonstrate, because that's the kind of compassion that Jesus demonstrates to us. And aren't you glad that when you were at your most desperate, needy point, Jesus didn't look you up and down and score you whether you should receive some compassion? And if he did that, I know I wouldn't get any. None of us would. But thanks be to God, he doesn't dole out compassion in measured scoops depending on how good we are. He offers it freely based on how much we need him. And the last thing I get from this story is the Samaritan's compassion was expressed in action. He didn't just say, "Boy, that's tough. I'll pray for you." He didn't just say he cared. He showed he cared, even though it cost him time and energy and money. 1 John 3:17 says, "If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need, but has no pity on him, the love of God is not in him." There can be no love without action. Real Christians display compassion. They don't shut down the feelings in their gut when they see people in need or in pain. They do whatever they can about it. The problem is, we've gotten so good at insulating ourselves from the hurts of others. We watch it every day on TV, this information age. We have an overload of information. So we just shut it down, turn it off, and learn to be callous. We can be just like the lawyer in our scripture passage and ask, "Who's really my neighbor?" But Jesus' story can do the same thing to us that it did to him. Slap him in the face and shatter complacency. I realized last night that we all watch an awful lot of needy people in the news. Sometimes it's from riots, sometimes it's from natural disasters. They're so needy, they're crying on TV. And then we say things like, "Oh, this is so overwhelming. How can we possibly help all the needy people in the world? What can one person do?" Well, I suspect God is not asking us to help every person in the world, but to help the ones we can. Let me close with a little story I'm sure you've heard some variation of. A man was walking on the beach, and he saw a little boy throwing starfish into the waves. When the man caught up with the little boy, he said, "Why are you doing that, son? Why are you throwing those starfish into the water?" And the little boy said, "If they stay out in the sun, they'll die." And the man said, "Yeah, but the beach is so long and there's millions of starfish that need help." Well, the little boy picked up another one and threw it into the ocean. And he said, "Well, I made a difference to that one." Mother Teresa was once asked how she accomplished all the great things she did. She said this, "None of us can do anything great on our own, but we can all do one small thing with great love." My friends, Jesus calls us to be real Christians, to display real love to those who need it, and to do small things with great love. Amen. Come to our prayer time, let me remind you of some of the concerns of our church. We're praying continued prayers for Jack Young, by Hannah, Bobby Klingensmith. She's here this morning. We're glad to see you, Bobby. Dave McCann, Celestine Purry, Tracy Herring, Patricia Zappone, Cynthia Mario, Lisa, Matthew, Gary, Richard, Tom, Kurt, Rachel, Judy, Alice Payne, Edith, and Ian, the teenage nephew of the Tuckers. I understand he's making some improvement, and his mom thinks it's the power of prayer, so we want to continue our prayers for him. We're praying for Bobby Mario's granddaughter, Lexi, and her family in North Carolina. We're praying for Effie Russell. We're praying for this is tongue-in-cheek, Jen Barr, she's in the marathon today. And seriously, we want to pray for Michelle Cook Stewart, our soloist. She was due back today, but there was a death in her family, so we want to keep her family in our thoughts and prayers. Are there any other joys or concerns to share?
Bob.
Okay, for Bob. Let's join our hearts and minds in prayer because God has called us to pray for each other. God of glory, this morning we respond in gratitude for your great love and grace. We thank you for hope that bursts upon us like the bright sunshine of the morning. We thank you for wisdom that enables us to see how all the fragments of life come together to make us whole. We thank you for faith that steadies us when we feel buffeted by the currents of life. We thank you for the love that overcomes hostility and fear. We pray for your children in all parts of this world. O God, give our leaders the wisdom to seek your will for peace and to pursue it. We are also concerned for those close to home, members of our church family and friends who have unique needs this day that we have already shared with each other. We pray knowing that your care will surround them and that we, as your instruments, may also be called upon to encircle them as a witness to your love. Come, Creator Spirit, and dwell here among us. Be with this family of yours, O God, here in this sanctuary this morning or worshiping with us elsewhere. May we always remember that we, your people, are the church. Help us all to do your will, to do justice, show love and mercy, and walk humbly with you. As we walk forward into the future, make us sensitive to what you are doing so that we will be part of the living history that you are writing through Jesus Christ. Guide us by your sure hand. With the confidence that comes from being your beloved children, we are bold to pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
For love alone, I will speak my word. visit my Lord. I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
Please know that you're invited to coffee hour today. It's in Fellowship Hall, so please go back. There's some goodies there, some cinnamon buns. We're all waiting for those from Steve. And now may the God who created all that is, may the God, the Redeemer, who redeemed all of creation, and may God, the life-giving Spirit, be with you and with all those whom you love today and forever. Amen.
Finding more power.